Hello friends, welcome back to my channel. I hope that you're doing well. Welcome to another video. Today, I'm doing something a little bit different, but also really exciting. I'm going to be recommending you guys some books based off of genres that I have read that I think that you guys will really enjoy. So I'm going to be recommending three books for each category. And I chose only genres that I've read three or more of, actually more than three of that particular genre, just to give you guys a good option. If I've only read three, then I would only recommend three. And if not all three of those books were good, then I don't want to recommend them to you. So we have seven categories to talk about today. And I will start with the genres that I've read the most of and then dwindle my way down to the ones that I read the least of. But other than that, that's pretty much all that I have to explain. So let's go ahead and get into the video. Okay, the first genre that we're going to talk about today is fantasy. I love fantasies. I've read a ton of them this year. Out of all the books that I've read this year, I've read 45 fantasy books. It's a lot. It's a lot. But I've enjoyed pretty much all of them for the most part. Some of them have been hit or miss, but other than that, it's been a pretty good year for fantasy. So let's go ahead and talk over some fantasy recommendations. For most of these books, they are all either YA or adult. I have no middle grade to recommend to you guys today. But that's because I don't read as much middle grade as I do everything else. So, without further ado, let's talk about some fantasy books. Okay, so not on purpose, but somehow all three of the books that I ended up choosing for fantasy are all read. So, am I sensing a theme here? I think so. But other than that, let's talk about them. So the first one I want to talk about is Nocturna. I read this several months ago now, but I really, really enjoyed it. It was such a fun time. It was a lot of fast-paced intrigue and, you know, you're questioning things to the very end because you really don't know what's going on. But this follows a prince who is ready to step up to, well, not ready. It is time for him to step up to his place in the kingdom as the king. However, he's really reluctant to do so because his brother was supposed to take that position. And unfortunately, his brother died under mysterious circumstances. And I think his name is Alfie, yeah. Alfie is determined to figure out what happened to his brother and see if it's possible that he's still alive. And so he's on this journey to figure that out when he runs into and becomes very well acquainted with a very well-known thief in their kingdom. And the two of their lives intertwine in crazy ways, and they end up having to save the world, basically, save their kingdom from the crazy monstrous things that are hidden within. So this has a really awesome magic system. I think that it's really awesome, really fast paced, really easy to start. And it's the first book in a series, and the second book has not been released yet. So this is like the perfect book to pick up if you just want something really fun, really easy, and still really intriguing and keeping you gripped to the very end of the book. The next two books I'm going to talk about are books that I read actually very recently, and the first one being Vicious by V.E. Schwab. I adored this book, and I think that it's such a fun, different type of book. This is about Victor and Eli, who are best friends in college and are very hellbent on trying to figure out how EOs are created. EOs are extraordinaries, and it's people that basically have really awesome extraordinary powers. But they find out very early on in the book that in order to become an EO, you have to have a near-death experience. In order to create those powers, you have to die and then come back to life, and then you will have powers. However, we know that all of that is happening, but you're flashing between the 10 years ago timeline and the now timeline, and Victor is just getting out of jail, and Eli and Victor hate each other, and you have no idea why. So you're just finding that out as you go along, and it's so much fun. This has a wonderful found family trope. It deals with superhero-esque individuals, and both characters are very morally gray. Almost actually all of the characters in this book are all morally gray, and it's just so fun to watch like what they do and the decisions that they make. And even though they are morally gray characters making morally gray decisions, you're like rooting for the main characters through most of the book. And I just really enjoyed it. I think that it's a fun book. If you're looking for something a little bit different, I would definitely recommend this one. All right, now we're going a little bit more magical. Let's talk Where Dreams Ascend. And when I say magical, I mean magicians. This is a fantastic, fantastic debut novel from a fantastic author. This follows a girl named Kalia, who is an aspiring magician. I swear I can speak English. And it also follows a couple of other very key individuals. You follow Judge DeMarco, who is judging this magical competition that's going on, as well as Jack, who is basically what they call the master. And all of their lives intertwine in some way, shape, or form. And you're following this really awesome magical competition. There are murders and disappearances and mysteries. And people just start dropping like flies left and right. And Kalia and DeMarco are trying to figure out not only what's going on, but also figure out if their budding romance can survive. This was amazing. I cannot. This gives you Greatest Showman vibes. This gives you Zendaya and Zac Efron vibes. This is everything that I wanted in this book and more. I loved it. And if you haven't read it yet, please do. All right, fantasy is done. Let's move on to romances. I have read 37 romances this year. That's a lot. You know what? I'm not ashamed. I enjoyed it, I'm not gonna lie. But let's go ahead and talk over those. And I would like to say that I showed very well intended restraint, and I didn't even recommend House of Earth and Blood. Are you proud of me? I know, it's amazing. All right, for my romance picks, this one definitely airs more on the side of contemporary, but it is very romance driven, and so I decided to pick this one, and that's because I loved it so much. And that is Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda. Wow, I swear I can speak English. By Becky Abertalli. I love this. This is queer. The main character is gay and is figuring out how to come out to his family. However, it involves somebody blackmailing him with the information of knowing that he is gay, as well as these emails that he sent back and forth to his secret anonymous pen pal, that they are creating a relationship. And it's a hard-hitting book when it comes to the blackmailing and the homophobia and things like that, but it's also a very heartwarming and hopeful book, and I just really enjoyed it. I love the fact that the Simonverse is a Simonverse. It's books built up as a companion series that follow different characters in Simon's life that interconnect some way, shape, or form, and it was such a fun series. Well, I've only read two books in the series, but it's been such a fun series to read. But definitely recommend Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda if you haven't already read it. And then, of course, if you really like it, you can go watch the movie. And that was very much entertaining as well. It was really hard for me to pick the romances that I wanted to talk about because I wanted to kind of give you guys recommendations that I haven't talked about before. But I feel like with romance, I'm very quick to gush about the things that I love. So most of the books that I have on my shelves that I love that are in the romance category, I have talked about a ton. So hopefully you guys haven't read these and you need another push to read them because they're great. The next one I'm going to talk about is Beach Read by Emily Henry. I adored this book. This book holds a special place in my heart because I remember sitting on my couch in the middle of the night reading this and sobbing at the end. And it was happy tears. It was good tears. But I just remember the impact that it had on me as a reader. And it was just so much fun to watch the story play out. This follows two main characters who are writers, and they both end up at this summer, like, beach houses for the summer. And they're both in the middle of having extreme writer's block. So they end up making a pact to switch genres and write each other's genres. And through that, they also create a relationship. But the thing that I love so much about this particular romance is not only are you getting the romance, but you're getting some really hard-hitting topics as well. Gus, the guy main character, is going through a lot in his personal life that you don't find out until later, so I won't spoil that. But also, January, who's the main girl character, just lost her dad, and she finds out that her dad had this big secret, and she doesn't know who or what to trust anymore, and she's having a really hard time coping with the fact that not only is he gone, but she's now trying to grapple with his own secrets as well as let go and grieve. So it was just a fantastic romance, and it's really interesting because it's supposed to be a beach read, and I feel like it balanced the lightheartedness with the hard-hitting topics well, but it's definitely not a romance that I expected. I'll just say that. There's also some talks of cults in here. Like, there's a lot of stuff pushed into this book, and I felt like it all balanced out well. I loved the characters. The steamy scenes were steamy, and I loved it, and I will definitely be rereading this sometime soon. And of course, I think that everyone knew this was coming. I could have recommended either one of the books in this companion novel series, but I had to go with Get a Life, Chloe Brown by Talia Hibbert. I will say Take a Hint, Danny Brown was amazing as well. I gave them both 5 stars. I loved them so much, but I think I loved Get a Life, Chloe Brown just a little bit more. I adore these characters. I love the fact that there's a very cute cat, and the characters as a whole, it was so much fun to watch them fall in love. And this is a hate to love romance, although I would definitely say if you are a very avid reader of hate to love, this probably isn't going to be enough hate for you, but I think that it worked perfectly for me. I love the characters. This book is steamy to the max, but it was amazing. This follows Chloe Brown, who at the very beginning of the book has a near-death experience, and she decides that as she's standing there on the street and her life flashes before her eyes, that she has not done anything exciting or fun with her life. So she decides to get a life. So she makes a list of all the things that she would like to do, and she enlists the help of her landlord. His name is Red, and she hates him, and he hates her, but things happen and bloom from there. There's also some representation for chronic pain in here, which is amazing. So it's just a fantastic book all in all. I loved how everything came together, and I think that as a whole, this whole companion novel series is going to be amazing. I can't wait for the third book because the sisters as a whole just really work well together, and then their love interest just, it works. Please read it. Okay, let's move on to some contemporaries. Now, I have read 26 contemporaries this year, and I feel like a lot of the times contemporaries can also be romances and romances can be contemporaries, but I find that times I talk about contemporaries, they focus a little bit less on the romance and more on character growth. And so I have one book in here that has romance in it and is a very central part of the plot, but I feel like the character growth was a little bit more important than the romance itself. So let's start with a very cut and dry contemporary, and that is A Slay by Brittany Morris. This was amazing. Like, amazing. This follows a girl, I can't remember her name now, Kira, who has created this really awesome, fantastical online game, but she created it for Black people. It's a Black-based community where people that are Black and all around the world can come and share in their Black culture and thrive in it and not feel judged or feel like they have to hide who they are for this community. However, something happens to one of the characters that plays this game in real life, and this particular game gets thrust into the spotlight, and the questions of race and racism and exclusion come up quite a bit, and Kira is now forced to defend what she's created, her game, her pride and joy of her life, while also trying to come to terms with racism in her own life and figuring out how to cope with that. And it was just fantastic. It's a wonderful book that just touches on so many awesome topics, but also has some good, lighthearted, contemporary reading in here. The game was explained in so much detail, and it was just so much fun to read. I definitely recommend this if you're looking for a good contemporary that has some hard-hitting topics but knows how to lighten the mood. So definitely recommend this one. I feel like I wouldn't do this author justice if I didn't recommend at least one of her books, and that is The Poet X by Elizabeth Acevedo. I could have definitely chosen Clap When You Land because that one was also amazing, but this one just hit me a little bit harder. This follows a girl named Siamata who is really struggling with her life as a whole. She is has grown up in a very, very religious family, and she's not really sure how she feels about religion, and she doesn't feel like she's able to question it because her mother is very hardcore. Go to church, say your prayers, do everything that a good Christian should do, and she's really struggling with that. She's also really trying to find a way to share her voice, share her words, and so she ends up getting wrapped up into spoken word or slam poetry, and it's just her story. This entire book is written in verse, and it was just such a hard-hitting, wonderful contemporary, but also deals with some really hard-hitting topics, and I definitely recommend this. This book made me cry. This book hit in all of the right feels, and I loved it. Also, if you do read this, I highly recommend the audiobook because it just brought the story to life so much more, especially because it's told in verse. It was just amazing. All right, this is the last book that I have for this particular genre, and this is the one where I was saying this has some romantic themes in here, but I feel like the character growth is really the majority of the book, and that is The Anti-Virginity Pact by Katie Wimser. I have talked about Katie Wimser on my channel more times than I can count. She is a booktuber and a self-published author, and I absolutely adore everything that she has written. This follows a girl named Meredith who her and her best friend decide to make an anti-virginity pact, and the pact is that by the end of their senior year in high school, they are just starting their senior year, that they will no longer be virgins. And so she sets out on this journey to basically get into a relationship with this guy that she's had a huge crush on for forever. And this pact has finally given her the courage to jump into that. And that is a big part of the book, but also she's really struggling with religion. I think this really closely ties to the poet X, but her father is actually a pastor, so she's a PK, and she's really struggling with the fact that she's atheist and she doesn't believe in God, but she doesn't know how to talk to her parents about that. And unfortunately, when the pact gets leaked and her family finds out, things really change and shit hits the fan. This has some really hard-hitting topics: bullying, slut shaming, talk of religion. It's a hard book to read, but man, was it fantastic. There's also some trigger warnings for animal abuse, but it's handled really, really, really well and talked about awesomely. So I definitely recommend this book if you're looking for a really awesome contemporary with some more romantic things going on in there, but so, so good. All right, next up, we're jumping significantly down a number, but the next up is thrillers, and I've read 10 of these. This is a little bit of a harder category for me to recommend because I don't read a ton of them, but I think that showing you guys some of the things that I really enjoyed in the thriller genre is good for those who don't read thrillers and will hopefully find something that they find enjoyable. So the first one I'm going to recommend is one that I don't actually own, and this is definitely a bit of a softer thriller. There's thriller aspects to it. I would say more mystery aspects, mystery thriller. I don't really know how to explain it, but I think that it's a good entrance into reading something that has more mystery thriller vibes to it, and that is Big Little Lies by Leanne Moriarty. I really loved this book. I think that it was a really awesome book to read. Not only are you getting the concept of somebody has died, and you don't know who it is, and you're following the story all the way up until you figure out what actually happened on this trivia night, but it follows these very snarky moms, and they're all moms to kindergartners, and so you're just following their lives and the little things that lead up to what this big mystery killer reveal is. And it was just a lot of fun to read. I think it's very easy, very simple, and if you like things that are more contemporary, I think that you'll really love this book because you get the contemporary vibes, but you also get the mystery thriller vibes towards the end. And I feel like it was a very satisfying ending. I felt like I had all the answers that I needed, and I really enjoyed it. So I don't own it anymore. I did unhaul the book, but not because I didn't love it, just because I don't see myself rereading it. But other than that, definitely recommend. Okay, up next, we're going to talk about The Other People by CJ Tudor. I talk too fast, and those words don't go together, right? but I really enjoyed this book. I think I gave it a 3 or 4 star. I can't really remember right off the top of my head anymore. But I think that this is one of the first thrillers that I read. I enjoyed it. I think that it had some paranormal-y aspects to it that I think some people would like. However, for me, the paranormal aspects weren't concluded enough for me. I didn't have enough answers in the paranormal realm, but the mystery thriller aspect definitely was satisfied. This follows a man who is on his way home from work, and he is on the phone with his wife saying, "Hey, I'm going to be late." He's leaving her a voicemail and just saying, "I'm sorry, I'm going to be late." And he is looking out his front window, and he sees his daughter, or what he perceives to be his daughter, in the back of a car, and she mouths "daddy," and the car just takes off. And he is like frantic, trying to figure out what happened to his daughter, because he knows that was her in the back of the car, or he thinks he knows. And he ends up chasing the car, and then he loses them on the freeway. And right after that, he gets a call from the police saying that he needs to come home because his wife and daughter were murdered, and their bodies are there. And he's like, "I just saw my daughter. How is that possible?" So this is his story of him trying to figure out the mystery of if that daughter was the daughter that they found was actually his, and if it wasn't, then who was the little girl that he saw in the back of the car. It's a really interesting story. There, like I said, there is some paranormal aspects, but I really enjoyed it. I think that it probably won't be for everybody, but I enjoyed it, and if you haven't given it a try, I would say do it. All right, and the last thriller that I'm going to recommend is Home Before Dark by Riley Sager. This follows a girl whose father has just died, and she's dealing and grappling with that. However, the bigger mystery and questions that she has in her life is years ago, 25 years ago, her and her family lived in this very interesting and very well-known house, and they stayed there for 20 days. And after the 20th day, they fled and never returned. And her father ended up writing a book about it, but she doesn't believe that anything that was written in the book was true, and her parents never told her the truth. And so she is hellbent on trying to figure out what really happened, why they really fled the house that night, and why they never returned. And it does have some paranormal aspects to it, 100%. I liked the ending enough. I did actually like the ending. I didn't care for the paranormal aspects because it didn't scare me enough. Personally, for me, I wanted to be scared and I didn't get that. But I think that if you like haunted houses and you're into things like that, this is definitely the book for you. I've heard pretty much everyone say that they loved it, except for most people didn't enjoy the ending. And I have to say that I like the ending, but I can see why people wouldn't love it. But overall, fantastic book. This is one of the only thrillers that I've kept on my shelves that I've decided to keep. I'm still teetering between whether or not I want to keep The Other People, but Home Before Dark will definitely stay on my shelves and I will definitely reread it during the Halloween time. Okay, this next one was actually really hard for me because I have read 10 paranormal books, but most of those were Twilight. So this one was a little bit harder, and I don't think that I quite figured out what I'm going to do for my third recommendation, but I do have two paranormal recommendations for sure that I would like to share with you guys. The first one I don't own, and that is the Black Dagger Brotherhood series by J.R. Ward. If you guys have been watching my channel for the last couple of months, you've seen me gush about the series multiple times. This follows a group of vampires called the Black Dagger Brotherhood, and they are basically the creme de la creme of vampires, and they are tasked with keeping their species alive. And each book follows a different member of the Brotherhood and them finding their mates, but also fighting this unit of people who are trying to kill off all vampires and make them extinct. So these are very smutty, very adult, very insta-love, very chosen mate-esque, but I love them. If you're just open for a good time, having a lot of fun, I definitely recommend this. It was so much fun, and still, I am excited to continue to read on to the series. I'm hoping to read number 4 very, very soon, and 100% recommend it if you're looking for a good, smutty, sexy, paranormal adult romance. All right, the next series I'm gonna recommend as a whole is the Secret Keeper series. I'm only gonna show you the first one, and that is House of Darkin. This is by Jamin Eve, and this follows a group of girls who are interconnected in ways that they don't quite understand. But the first book follows, what is her name? Emma, and she ends up in this small town by mysterious circumstances, and her guardians end up going missing. And the housing neighborhood that she lives in only has one rule, and that is to stay on your side of the housing track. So you have the poor side and the very rich side, and the only rule is not to cross over to the other side. And when her guardians go missing, she decides, fuck the rules, I need to figure out what happened to them. I'm going straight over there and asking them questions. And she ends up getting pulled into this very expansive, crazy world that has to do with maybe some paranormal aspects. I don't want to spoil too much for you, but I will say that it's an incredible series that ties all the books in together so well. It's a very found family group, and I loved it so much. Definitely recommend. This is so underhyped, and it's because it's a self-published book, but man, did I have a lot of fun reading this. All right, and then the last recommendation, I can't figure out what I want to recommend to you guys. I've read Twilight, the entirety of the Twilight series. I've read Fallen by Lauren Kate. Don't want to recommend that one. And I've also read two books out of the Marked or the House of Night series by PC Cast and Kristen Cast. And all of those are kind of hard recommendations because they're all very old, not very timely. But out of those three series, I would recommend Twilight because I just had a lot of fun with the series. If you're willing to read the series without any gripe or trying to read too harshly into what was written, then I think you can have a lot of fun. Is this book series problematic? Absolutely. Are some things that when I was reading it, I really wished weren't included in the story? Yes. But were they fun to reread? Absolutely. So if you need a push to reread the series, or if you want to read the new, what is this? It's not a companion novel, whatever. It's the book written in Edward's perspective, then I would 100% recommend. There you go, that's my third recommendation for you. This video is getting very long, but the next recommendation I have for you is graphic novels, and I have read 8 graphic novels this year. Doesn't seem like a lot, but I have found 3 that I loved, so let's talk about them. I'm gonna save the best for last. We're gonna start with Paper Girls by Brian Vaughn, I think his name is. It doesn't say on the front, but yeah, Brian K. Vaughn. Liked this a lot. This is a sci-fi, interesting book. It's kind of hard to explain, honestly, but basically this apocalyptic weird situation is going on in this town, and the paper girls, which the girls are on the paper route, all end up kind of together, and they are on the run for their lives trying to survive and figure out what the hell is happening. And I still don't understand, but I definitely need to read more. So if you're looking for a fun, interesting, graphic novel series. 100% recommend this. Another one that's a little bit weird, also written by Brian K. Vaughan. This is Saga Volume 1. I read this recently and really enjoyed it. This is a sci-fi graphic novel that follows two individuals that are married and just had a baby. However, these two individuals are part of two separate species that are in a huge war against each other. And so when the government finds out that they have conspired treason together, basically, they are now hunted down and they are trying to kill the parents and their newborn baby. And so they're on the run and it's their story, but it's told from the daughter's perspective and it's so cool, so cute, definitely adult. I flipped a couple pages in and I was like, what the hell am I working? It was a lot. It's definitely adult. Please keep that in mind. But other than that, really enjoyed it. And last but certainly not least, and of course there was no way I could not recommend this graphic novel series, and that is Heartstopper. The whole graphic novel series, fantastic, love this. This follows Nick and Charlie. I always get their names confused. Charlie is openly gay, Nick is trying to figure out his sexuality, and they end up creating this very interesting relationship where you're finding their relationship is budding, but Nick doesn't really know how to accept that and is coming to terms with what he wants, who he is, if he wants to label himself or not. And it's just a fantastic series as a whole. It's so cute and warm and cuddly, and every time I read it, I'm left smiling and wanting more. So 100% recommend if you haven't already read it. And if I didn't mention, this is written by Alice Oldman. All right, the very last genre that I'm going to be doing recommendations for today is nonfiction. And I have read 7 nonfiction this year, and almost every single one of them has been a memoir except for one, which is on this list today. And so I'm going to recommend 3 nonfictions that I really enjoyed, and I'm hoping that you will enjoy too. So the first one I'm going to talk about is one that I don't own but loved, and that is Born a Crime by Trevor Noah. This follows Trevor Noah's story from when he was born all the way up until kind of present day. But basically, Trevor Noah was born in Africa in the time of apartheid, and apartheid basically meant that it was illegal to be born mixed or to be in a relationship with a mixed person, anything like that. But Trevor's dad was white and his mom was black, and so he was literally a crime. And his mom spent a lot of time hiding him, keeping him sheltered, because she didn't want him to be caught and punished for being alive. And so his story is incredible. I laughed, I cried, I got chills, I got goosebumps. It was amazing. If you haven't listened to this or heard the story, please read it. I recommend the audiobook. Trevor Noah narrates it. I couldn't think of the word. Narrates himself, and it was amazing, incredible. 100% recommend. All right, up next we're going to talk about So You Want to Talk About Race. I can never say this individual's name. Ijeoma sorry, I butchered it. I know, I always butcher it. But this book, amazing. If you're looking for a good anti-racism book that's gonna give you all the education in a very digestible, easy to understand way, this is the one for you. I listened to the audiobook. It was phenomenal. So good. I spent so much time just digesting her words and listening to what she had to say about racism, microaggressions, intersexuality, just simple things like talking about hair, and it was amazing. I spent so much of this book nodding in agreement and totally resonating with what she was saying, but also really questioning, like, myself as an individual when it comes to racism, because even though this book focuses on racism against black people, it also makes you think about the type of racism that you have been subjected to or allowed others to be subjected to from yourself, that you didn't even realize that you were doing. And I know that I'm guilty of that. Most people are. Most people have done or said something that is somehow inherently racist. And just learning to accept that, figuring out how to properly apologize, and learning from it. And it was amazing. 100% recommend this. Please read it if you haven't already, and I 100% recommend the audiobook. All right, the last book of today's video and my favorite memoir that I've read to date, and that is We're Gonna Need More Wine by Gabrielle Union. This is a fantastic memoir about Gabrielle Union's life, and I will say this has trigger warnings for rape, murder, gun violence, gang violence. There's a lot of stuff in here, but it's told so well. Again, I listened to the audiobook, 100% recommend. Gabrielle Union narrates it herself. It was so good. But this is the first book that I ever read that made me feel seen. And Gabrielle Union talks about growing up in a predominantly white neighborhood and feeling like, you know, obviously she doesn't fit in because she's not white enough. And then transferring and growing up into a prominently black neighborhood and feeling like she doesn't fit in. And that is how I felt most of my life, and sometimes still do to this day. And man, I've never felt more seen in a book than I had when I read this. And I loved it. I loved it so much. It was amazing. It was fantastic. Please read it. Just take my word for it and read it. And I don't think that you'll be disappointed. So that's it. That is all the books that I'm going to recommend you based on different genres. I know this video was very long, so if you made it to the end, woo, props to you. And today's emoji is going to be a wine glass. A wine glass with alcohol. If you're not of age, it's okay. Nobody's drinking here. But after all this filming, I need a glass of wine. So that's so random. Sorry. But welcome to my channel if you're new. But that is the end of this video. I hope that you guys enjoyed it. I would love to know what books that you recommend in the genres that I talked about today. Please let me know down below, because I will definitely for sure try to get my hands on them and read them. But that is it. That is the end of this video. I hope that you enjoyed it. If you did, please make sure to give it a big old thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe before you leave. And of course, leave any comments, questions, and suggestions in the comment section below. And I will see you in the next video. Bye!